Welcome back to the latest part of Alchemy Xtra. I'm speaking with Des Carty, as I have been over the last number of weeks, about the book Irish Life and Me, Tales of the Criminal Cabal, in which we've been discussing a real-life case of a man who we're calling Tom, who has taken on and, well, quite successfully to my mind, and the story will unfold over the coming weeks, but quite successfully taken on the banks and the legal institutions that have attempted to enslave him in an economic sense. And up to now, Des, we've been talking about some of the tools that Tom used prior to any solicitors getting involved and the questions that he was asking the banks to try and, I suppose, build up his arsenal of weaponry that he could eventually use if he was dragged into the boxing ring, to use our analogy, or the courtroom. So we're up to chapter 7. By the way, welcome back again.
Thank you. Yeah.
We're up to chapter 7 and some very interesting developments taking place at this point. We've already asked for the information from the banks under data protection and the various rules, and we've basically put the bank on notice that we're quite serious about what's going on, and as expected, they haven't responded at all.
Yeah, the usual thing, John. Again, thanks for reiterating that. Up to chapter 7, a few letters have been going back and forward. The regulators, Tom tried to tie the regulators in, not much of a response from those. The data request was sent in, no response to that, which is a breach of the Act itself by not sending out the data and information that Tom was legally entitled to. And then, obviously, the bank failed, refused and neglected to answer any of the questions under the Central Bank Reform Act 2010. This is where, as you said earlier, the bank weren't too happy. And specifically, they weren't happy, I think, with the last letter that Tom sent in relation to final notice demand, telling the bank that because they had failed, refused, and neglected to engage, i.e. send information, that they were precluded now from doing so. So the bank just decided to seemingly ignore that letter as well, to a point, and bring in a solicitor. And as Chapter 7 is titled, Legal Prostitution.
Yeah.
Now, again, we don't want people to take this in the wrong way, because we had a woman maybe a year ago that said to us, my daughter is a solicitor and she's not a prostitute. And we don't mean it in that context, in a literal context.
Well, what I mean, would be worth looking up the definition of prostitute, I think, because it's not always a sexual meaning. I mean, it's not always what we see on the news when we're talking about prostitution, really.
Exactly. So in a nutshell, what we inferred here was that the solicitor was prepared to sell his wares or goods or prostitute himself for law, or sell law, if you like. And what will become evident for people when they read this chapter, and I think you should read this chapter over and over quite a few times, is that the solicitor that got involved with Tom at that stage didn't actually know what he was talking about. But that became evident because of the approach he took. So on the 10th May-ish, thereabouts, Tom received a letter. And I got the letter because it's an interesting kind of approach, not forgetting that Tom had basically said to the bank, now you're precluded from progressing any further because you have not submitted any evidence to support your allegations, which they hadn't. So the letter reads, Dear Sir, as in Tom, we are instructed by our above-named client, i.e. Irish Life Permanent TSB, to write to you following recent correspondence received from you. Please note that we have been instructed by our client to issue proceedings against you for recovery of the following property on foot of arrears of mortgage payments. Now, he didn't state alleged arrears. He was categorically stating there was arrears there. Okay. Our clients do not... Now, this is interesting, John. Very interesting statement from a solicitor. Our clients do not propose to respond to your correspondence. Okay? He was saying there, our clients are going to ignore what you've asked them. In other words, we know you've written to our client looking for information and data to support their allegations, but they have decided that they will not answer your questions. Okay? Mm. So they have decided to withhold alleged evidence that they may have to rely upon later. Now, whether or not this solicitor, and we named the solicitor, it was Michael Bulger from Gibbons Exam Solicitors. I think they're in Cork. This solicitor was making a terrible admission. So he was saying that they were prepared as solicitors to go ahead without any alleged evidence being provided to support the allegations of the bank. Now, that on its own is bad enough, but for this to come from a solicitor, or what they call an officer of the court, so a solicitor in its capacity, external and internal to the court, is operating as an officer of the court. So he was saying, I am prepared to go ahead with this, irrespective of the fact that my client, Permanent TSB, Irish Life, do not have any evidence or alleged evidence sent to you to support their allegations. Now, that is just amazing, right? So the next sentence is, however, we are instructed to inform you that the individuals referred to in your correspondence reserve the right to take such steps as are appropriate, including, if necessary, the issue of proceedings for defamation, to protect themselves from the allegations contained in your correspondence. So obviously, they took issue with the fact that Tom had now dubbed Irish Life Permanent TSB the Criminal Cabal, because we were operating as a Criminal Cabal, and he had inferred or alleged that they had committed offences in terms of all sorts of stuff. And certainly, it was very demonstrably clear that they were failing, refusing, and neglecting to proffer information that they were directed to do so. So what this was a if the average man getting this letter, it would probably, I'm not just being disingenuous now to the average man on the street, but it would probably frighten them, especially when they use the word defamation. So that was the intent of this letter, was to frighten Tom. Now, when Tom got the letter, he wasn't frightened, to be honest with you. He's like everybody else. When you get a letter like this from a solicitor, the first thing you are is afraid.
Yeah.
So we said to Tom, look, park the letter, read the letter, park it, let it sit overnight, give us a copy, and we'll come back in a few days' time. We'll talk to you about it, or a day or two, whatever it was. And he did. And Tom went up and he looked up what defamation was. And we said, well, Tom, have you committed defamation? He said, well, what do you mean have I committed defamation? I said, well, have you lied? Have you told any lies? Because I said, that's the only thing that can be defamatory, i.e. they can only sue you for defamation if you've told lies.
Yeah.
And he said, no, I haven't told lies. I said, well, there's no issue then, is there?
Exactly.
And he said, no, if you're telling the truth, you can't be accused of, well, you can be accused of defamation, obviously, but of course, you can't be found guilty of defamation. It was the truth. So the word defamation was put in there to frighten Tom, but it didn't work because, you know, we were backing him up and all that. So yeah, that's what we call the curveball. They were trying to, you know, frighten him. So this guy, Michael Bulger, went on and he wrote this letter. And so what we decided with Tom was to write to Michael immediately, advising him of our, what we said to Tom was, well, we have a guy over here. He does a bit of work for us. His name is Rob. And to help alleviate the bit of weight on your shoulders, we'll ask Rob to start engaging the bank and the solicitor as your third party representative, which Rob agreed to do. And Rob was quite good at writing letters. So that alleviated some of the pressure from Tom as well, because Tom was writing all these letters. Now, it didn't remove him totally, because he had to draft up the letters for Rob, and then Rob would top them and tail them. So Rob then commenced writing to the bank on behalf of Tom, and writing to the solicitors on behalf of Tom. Now, to add to that, we directed Tom to trademark his name. Now, I don't know, John, if you've trademarked the name that you use.
I have, yeah.
But, okay, so just for anybody that is out there listening, you can trademark your name in common law, which means that it's very analogous to going into McDonald's and then setting up a McDonald's the next day as McDonald's. McDonald's would be down on you like a fly on blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And you won't be there very long. So if you have a name that you're using and you wish to trademark it, it will give you a level of protection, because what you're saying, what you can then do is issue notice to the different parties, say not to use the name. Now, again, using the name John and whatever surname you use, it wouldn't be any harm. But if there's somebody specifically that was attacking you and you said to them, look, don't use the name John again, and you issue them the relevant notice, then they would be precluded in law, common law, from using the name.
Yeah.
And if they did use it, they'd be opening up themselves to a suit or perhaps fees and fines and damages. So we said to Tom, get your name trademarks, which he did. And then we can add that as well to your armory.
I think it's also worth mentioning at this point, Des, that we are operating in a common law jurisdiction, because sometimes when I've spoken to people about trademarking, one of the regular comments that comes back is, well, you haven't trademarked your name with the state body or whatever it might be, but it's perfectly fine to trademark your name in common law because we're operating in a common law jurisdiction here.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Now, that's actually a very good point I missed myself. But again, going back to the, as you say, the state registration, you can, of course, do a registered trademark with the state. But you see, when you register something, now, what you're doing here with, if you like, the common law trademark, you're actually just noting it, if you like, and telling everybody that it's trademarked, don't use it.
Yeah.
Now, when you register something, you're basically handing over your authority. So when you register something with the trademark with the state, and the name happens to be Tom Jones, then what you're doing is handing over the regulation and the control of that trademark to the state. They'll obviously charge you for it, and you'll have to comply with their rules and regulations. When you do something in common law, what you're saying is, I will govern this, I will control this, I will manage this myself. So then you have got control of it. Now, again, going back to the word register, registrar, it actually is the etymology of the word. Now, obviously, there'll be different variations of this, but the etymology of the word basically goes back to regis as in royal. Now, royalty being king or queen.
Yep.
And trade, or registre, trade, would be tree, T-H-R-E-E. So what you're doing is, when you register something, you're giving your authority to the authority, i.e. the state or the king or the queen, as in regis, regis, yeah, regis as in royalty. And then tre means you'll be giving them the authority under a name, a date of birth, and possibly an address as well. So you hand over your three forms of authority to them. So you lose control of it if you do a register a trademark. The same if you register anything else as well.
Yeah.
If you register a car, blah, 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 you're handing over the regulation and the ability to control that bit of property to the state. So you have to be governed then by what the state wants. It's the same when you sign on for the dole. You register for the dole, if you register for welfare or benefits. So you're handing over your authority for these people, for the state, not the people, for the state to govern what you do, which basically means you have to be compliant with all their rules, or else you're in contempt of their rules, and therefore they can prosecute you. So it can be quite a complex thing, but if people just look like this, when you register something, you hand over your authority to control it, own it, use it. And it's that simple. So when you trademark a name in common law, you don't. You simply notice people, or you give notice that that's your trademark. You have control of it. And if somebody else wants to use it, they'll have to apply to you to use it, if necessary. And if they use it or abuse it, when they've been notified or noticed, then you can charge them, fine them, fee them, whatever it might be. Mm. So it's quite a little good tool to have in your armory of protection. So we got Tom to do this, no problem doing that. And then, as I said, Rob got involved. And again, I'd suggest to people that they consider third parties at an appropriate stage coming in, not dealing totally autonomous from them, but perhaps taking direction from them. And anybody can be there as an authorized representative. You can get your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, a friend that you trust, an enemy that you trust. Anybody really can act as a third party once they have authority for you. So that meant that Rob could take some of the weight from Tom. So Rob wanted to get into this because he likes having a go at solicitors, to be honest with you. And so Rob said, okay, I'll take over with this. And he wrote to Michael Bulger. And now, will we read out the letter, John? It's a long letter, though. That's the only thing.
I do think worth reading it out, because a lot of people will have it in front of them as well. And if there's a point that needs to be clarified, we can do so then as we go along. Okay.
Right. Now, the letter is actually printed as well in the book, but we've typed it out as well so people can get a clear understanding of what was in the text. So they say on the letter at the top, it says notice demand for information, data and answers. So it was telling Michael Bolger. Now, this was also sent to all the other parties as well. Not forgetting that as well, folks. But the same letter was sent to everybody that was involved in this up to date, including Laura Skelly, who we wrote to earlier.
Yeah.
Right. Let's start reading it. Okay, so there's a reference number at the top, i.e. the reference alleged account number. And he also, Rob included, by return, he sent the original letter back to Michael Bolger because he didn't want to attach himself to. Now, there was a copy kept, obviously, for records. It says then, delivery of this document is constituted by way of a post-registered post, i.e. recorded post, by on post, ordinary post, and by email from moment of posting. So it was sent two or three different forms. For the record, this is to Michael Bolger. Dear Michael Bolger, for the record, you are aware by now we don't consider trouble in establishing that it was you that wrote the enclosed diatribe. So what Rob was saying there was that it was nonsense that was written, complete nonsense. Now, obviously, Michael Bolger wouldn't be too happy about that. Who cares? You did not have the good manners or professional etiquette to put your name to it or use a proper signature. What strange and suspicious behavior for a so-called solicitor or an apparent officer of the court? Signs are on you that you would write such a coercive and threatening letter, but yet withhold vital details that could or would inculcate you directly in any offences. It is well known that a court of competent and lawful jurisdiction take a dim view on this type and sort of behaviour. So basically, the background to that was Rob had called up on behalf of Tom trying to find out whom wrote the letter that was sent by O'Flynn's exam solicitors, because it wasn't clearly obvious that it was Michael Bolger. And he spent some considerable time trying to establish, because the people at O'Flynn's exam solicitor didn't want to disclose that it was Michael Bolger. Eventually, they did. And so that was iterated in the letter, that he had trouble in establishing who wrote the letter. It goes on then to say, you are in complete contempt of the terms of reference of this matter. Any and all correspondence referencing the Irish Life Permanent herein called the Criminal Cabal was and is to be copied to all of the parties listed above. You have attempted to willfully obfuscate the matter in hand by not mentioning or making reference to the Criminal Cabal mortgage account number, blah, blah, blah. So he wanted to put a few, I suppose, headbutts and punches in there, and he continued to refer to Irish Life Permanent TSB as the Criminal Cabal, and knew that would upset Michael, because Michael was trying to accuse Tom of defamation. So thought, well, let's wind him up a little bit. If indeed you, as you state, you have been or are appropriated to represent the interests of the Criminal Cabal, then as per the Data Protection Act 1988 and 2003 and the Freedom of Information Act 1997, forward a copy to us of your apparent appointment or deed of appointment alongside any and all and any data and information that is in your or O'Flynn's exam's possession relating to or indirectly to this matter. Please note that by your letter of the 10th of May 2012, you are already in breach of the Data Protection Act. That means that Irish Life Permanent TSB should have not sent Tom's details or an instruction to a solicitor prior to Tom having all the information that the bank were reliant upon.
Yeah.
So there, Rob was pointing out he was in breach of the Data Protection Act by accepting this. Therefore, it will do you no good to purposely and willfully withhold any or all the information and data that you may or may have or become reliant upon now or in the future. In other words, There's a thing we referred to earlier. It's a case called Summers versus Weir, wherein no solicitor should be progressing with any matter unless they have the full facts within their knowledge. Okay. In other words, the solicitor should not have progressed with this matter until he had all the evidence that his clients were relying upon. We go on then. We do not understand why you would wish to get involved with or inculcate yourself in a matter that which is currently within the investigative remit of the Data Protection Commissioner, the Information Commissioner, the Bank and Financial Ombudsman, the Consumer Services Agency, the Financial Regulator, the Bank and the Minister of Finance, the Central Bank and the Minister of Finance, Michael Noonan, not to mention the fact that your apparent client, the Criminal Cabal, are in fact in breach of the Data Protection Act, Freedom of Information Act, and the Central Bank Reform Act 2010. So when Michael Bolger got this letter, he would have realized, wow, I've dropped myself in it, right? I've dropped myself right in it, up to the neck. Because I would imagine, or we would imagine, that the bank had not fully disclosed all of the facts. Now, maybe they did, and Michael Bolger just decided to go ahead anyway. But I'd imagine the bank had have disclosed the full facts of this matter to Michael Bolger, he would not have taken up on this case. Mm. He just wouldn't have gone near it because it was too much of a mess. Then the letter goes on to say, you will need to write to all of the aforementioned commissioners and regulators and explain why, as your assertion that your apparent client, the Criminal Cabal, do not propose to respond to your correspondence. So we were quoting his words there and saying, well, explain, if you can, why your client are refusing to give information and data and not respond to our client, inverted commas. And that was a serious question because he would have given him information now whereby he would have been thinking, oh my God, what have I got myself into? We'd imagine. This will take some explaining as it is a flagrant disregard and an open contempt for the aforementioned acts and is an unconscionable and unconstitutional denial of rights by you and the Criminal Cabal. Equally, is in direct contravention of the Universal Declaration on Human Rights and the European Convention on Human Rights. What you are attempting to do is illegal and unlawful, not to mention morally and ethically reprehensible. For the purpose of absolute clarity, we did not and never have issued inquiries that which require responses. And as we said before, John, any questions we would direct people to ask are questions that require answers. They're not inquiries. Mm. So just clarify that with him there. We have issued very clear and unambiguous instructions, notices, and demands, and asked very serious and sobering questions, that which demand to be answered. Notwithstanding, those questions have yet to be answered. So again, these questions were not answered. So again, that would be given Michael Bolger notice that he should not have proceeded in this matter. As an officer of the court, this is direct again to Michael, as an officer of the court, you have a duty to us to not facilitate fraudulent misrepresentation, and certainly not to bring it into court. It is clear from your letter that you have no first-hand knowledge of any of the events leading up to this date. If it is your intention to continue in your actions, then on your head be it. As you know, perjury, fraudulent misrepresentation, contempt for the law stroke court, and barratry is punished severely and may end up with you being fined, the ruination of your business, being disbarred, and a possible prison sentence. In most recent days, the High Courts have dismissed one or two cases of this sort, with civil and criminal charges pending for both the solicitors and barristers involved. Ignorance of the facts and ignorance of the law will not help you. So again, we're just reiterating the law to him. Then it goes on to say, you and your client, the Criminal Cabal, have already demonstrated your contempt for the aforementioned acts, the Constitution, human rights, the law, and for due process. That is certain and without doubt. Therefore, you, Michael Bolger, in large letters, and or any of your colleagues, employees, and agents of O'Flynn's exam solicitors are not to write or correspond with or communicate in any manner whatsoever with Tom, trademark, or any derivatives of the name therein. Again, on this, be sure we are adamant. For the avoidance of all doubt, all of the aforementioned data, information, evidence, and questions that you have been asked is to be copied in its entirety and sent to all of the above listed parties. We mean them all. Anything and everything that you say, write, comment on, or do in any context whatsoever is on the record and will be treated with extreme prejudice, and everyone will know about it. The regulators will be interested in all you have to say. You can forward a copy of all the aforementioned demands for data, information, evidence, and answers to the questions that we have asked you, to and for the attention of the financial representative, name and address as follows. So again, that was to Rob. Do not contact Tom. If you fail, refuse, or neglect to disclose all data and information demanded herein, or fail, refuse, or neglect to answer all of the questions asked herein within 3 days of receipt of this letter, your non-response will constitute your agreement that you do not have any valid or law claim of rights in the aforementioned matters. Finally, the name Tom is copyright trademarked. We will address this matter to you in the private. So in other words, we'll write to him privately about the issue in relation to the trademark. So that's that letter. And let me just see, I'll move on, John. Have you any questions about that letter yourself, John?
Well, no, I just think it's worth noting that there's some real heavy artillery has been rolled out there. I mean, if I was a solicitor, and supposedly solicitors are meant to know the law, and I received a letter like that, I would be the one petrified, not Tom.
Well, that was the idea, to be honest with you. What we suspect, again, as we stated, that because of the language that O'Flynn's exam solicitors, through Michael Bolger, we suspected he did not know the full facts, and we were giving him an opportunity now to bring the full facts into his knowledge, which is a legal requirement. He has to do it. So, again, the letters were sent, that same letter was sent to all parties, including the bank, the whole lot. And to be honest with you, there wasn't much more done by Michael after that. He did write one or two trite, and I actually don't know. From memory, he didn't write an awful lot back. We did a little bit of research on him. He's not really much. I think he's a lecturer in one of the colleges down in Cork or Limerick or something. University College Cork, yeah. He's a lecturer, or was a lecturer, in University College Cork. So if anybody knows him, sure, Jesus, they might raise the issue in one of his classes about, you know, having knowledge. And raise the summers for, I'm sure it'll be a very touchy subject for him anyway.
I'd say he'd love it.
I don't think he would. But anyway, look, for the record again, it was laid out to Michael on more than one occasion, and the crux of it would be, and people can read this themselves in greater detail, that basically there was one or two letters written to Michael, and there was a closure letter of, it's called a notice of irrevocable estoppel by acquiescence, and he was put on notice about the trademark as well, that if he breached the trademark. Now, I think he did breach the trademark, and he was sent an invoice, but we didn't get into that in the book because we didn't want to go off cue too much. Mm. But at this point in time, O'Flynn's exam solicitors actually owe our friend here, Tom, a substantial amount of money. So they could find themselves up in the High Court themselves for this money, depending on how Tom feels at any point in time. But again, Michael didn't really offer much, and I think he was just scared stiff that if he did engage too far, then he'd be in a lot of trouble himself because he couldn't prove he had full facts of the knowledge. Mm. And the other thing was, something I'd say to people now, we didn't cover it in the book, but I think people should seriously consider this. If or when a solicitor does engage with them, they should look for what's called the solicitor's authority or letter of authority from the bank and demand it. And I think we, at some stage, we might have done that, but I don't think it's covered in the book. But it's an old word pointing out to people that if a solicitor does engage with you, you are legally entitled to have all the information that they have, and that would include their letter of authority or appointment. So you should insist on getting a copy of that as well. Mm. And they're very reluctant to give you that. Now, on top of that, John, just this will give more ammunition to people as well. All the solicitors out there, professional practices, so on and so forth, are required legally to have professional indemnity. I think we spoke about this before, but it's worth iterating it. Are you aware of what professional indemnity is?
I am, but I think it's worth talking about again because it's quite important and it's not necessarily in the public domain all that often or in common knowledge.
Right. We did, actually this information is on the Society's website. Now again, I couldn't quote the specific section to you, but it is there if people search in relation to the way solicitors have to operate. Now, first and foremost, solicitors have to have, legally, they are required to have professional indemnity insurance, which indemnifies them against any suits. Yeah. So it's an insurance, a form of insurance that they take out in case their own clients or anybody else for that matter sues them. And it saves them a ton of money. Now, I don't know how much it costs. I don't think it's the cheapest insurance in the world because it is professional indemnity. And they have to be sure insure for millions in case they do get sued. Now, when or if a solicitor does engage with you and they're attacking you or writing to you and saying you owe this and that and the other, two things you should look for, and we haven't covered this specifically or explicitly in the book because it's information that we didn't think was appropriate at the time. But the information is this. First of all, look for an attested copy of the solicitor's authority to operate on behalf of their alleged client, which would be the bank in this case. So you can seek that. You're legally entitled to get it. Second of all, the solicitors have to have professional indemnity insurance in place. And you are legally entitled to see who their insurers are. So if you look for a copy of their professional indemnity reference number, and details of who their insurers are. Now, you might think that doesn't mean a lot, but what it does is, what you're saying to the solicitor then is, potentially here, because of what you're doing, I could potentially sue you for what you're doing. So I want to know who you're insured by. That means then, by their own rules and the legality of it, the solicitor then has to inform their insurer that they have been requested to give their insurer's details, which means that potentially their insurance premium will go up. Okay?
Right.
Now, this hurts and hits the solicitors where it matters, in the pocket. Okay? Now, we tried out a few social experiments on this now for other parties. And one of the recent social experiments we tried out was, we had, there was a company called Pierce Fitzgibbons Solicitors.
Oh, yes.
I think they're down, are they in Kerry, is it, in Listowel?
Yeah, they're in Listowel, and many people will be familiar with them, my old friends.
Yeah. Your friends, are they your friends as well?
Oh, of course, yeah.
Well, Pierce Fitzgibbons Solicitors primarily act for two operations in the state. One is, they operate for, and they act on behalf of EFLO stroke, the National Toll Roads Association, and they also act and operate in some cases for the credit unions. Now, Pierce Fitzgibbons Solicitors are notoriously aggressive. I mean, I'm not being unfair there when I say that, but they're notoriously aggressive with what they do. As far as I'm concerned, they're hardened white-collar criminals. So a friend of ours came here and was struggling with an e-flow notice, i.e. a toll road notice, and she was really struggling with it. Now, she was afraid, and it had gotten to the point where, I think, over two toll road notices, they wanted in the region of €1,400 offer.
Yeah.
And they were taking no rubbish from her. So we directed her to write a couple of letters, and one of the final letters she wrote was demanding to see. Now, there was all information that we might have discussed in the past, John, was incorporated into her letters. And of course, Pierce Fitzgibbons and the National Toll Roads Association and EFLO and the Minister of Transport, none of these people came forward with any alleged evidence against this woman.
Yeah.
So the final nail in the coffin was, we phoned up on her behalf, or sorry, not we, but Rob phoned up on her behalf and Lucas, and he spoke to Pierce. What's it? Rhubarb Pierce.
Rhubarb Pierce.
The head,
yeah.
Each other. Yeah.
Rhubarb, I like to call him.
What did you say there, John? What did you call him?
Rhubarb Pierce, I think.
Rhubarb.
So that's certainly how I address him anyway.
He's very acidic, yeah, and bitter.
Yeah.
So Rob phoned up on behalf of this lady, and arrogance, talk about arrogance. The arrogance of this man, unbelievable. Now, I think he'd hit the number one spot for arrogance on the island.
Mm.
But he took a back step when Rob said to him, look, it's a friendly call. We just want to know, what is your insurance number? And he says, I'm not going to give you that information. And he says, well, you have to. Rob says, you have to, like, because we're legally entitled to it. Because if there's a potential suit here, you have to inform your insurers. And Rhubarb Pierce refused to give him the insurance details.
Mm.
That was fine, but you see that the call was just a bit of an experiment. Now, legally speaking, solicitors should have their insurance certificate put on their wall of their office. So it should be on the, I think, the reception of the office. And that's actually delineated in the Law Society's rules as well.
Okay.
So, you know, if you're stuck forgetting the details, you can always walk in. Now, if they haven't got it displayed, that's a breach of the rules of the Law Society, which they should be reported about. But Rhubarb refused blankly or blatantly to give the insurance details to Rob. That was fine. That was okay. You know, you can't have issue with that. If he's refused to do something, he's refused. But that could be used against him. So Rob wrote a letter to Rhubarb Pierce and to Pierce Fitzgibbons Solicitors and said, we did call on such and such a date, and you did willfully fail, refuse, and neglect. Would not inform us as to whether or not you had your insurance details displayed as per the Law Society's regulations. So that letter was written, I think, over a month and a half ago. Now, the context would be, as far as Pierce Fitzgibbons were concerned, this woman was guilty of sin, and next week they were going to go to court. Nothing was ever heard from Pierce Fitzgibbons again.
Right.
Okay. So it was iterated that he had refused to give these details. That copy of that letter sent into the Law Society for the attention of Ken Murphy, and so on and so forth. And all parties then, including EFLO, National Toll Roads, the Minister of Transport, knew what had happened. Okay, they were put on record. This is what happened. This guy refused, failed, blah, blah, blah. He has not proffered evidence to support his allegations. So that was, now we think that's the end of it. Now, if something comes back and something happens, that's fine. But that's over a month ago that that event occurred. And this woman was scared because she said, these people are going to bring me into court. And we said, look, just keep pushing. Keep asking. And you know yourself, John, from your own experience, I'd imagine, that you just have to keep pushing back and pushing back. And look, we don't know what they may or may do next. The same with the Irish Life and Me. We don't know what will happen with Tom in the future if Irish Life and Me will keep coming back. But so far, so good. And you can only take each day at a time, I think. So that's the story about looking for the... So again, just in summary, just so we haven't forgotten where we are, we suggest to people, if they're engaged by a solicitor, to immediately look for the professional indemnity details of the solicitor and seek a copy of their alleged appointment to stroke authority. So two things which the solicitors don't want to give you, and you should keep hammering those things on. But again, the solicitor has to go back to his insurer now and inform his insurer. So that should go into the letter as well, that we know, we're aware that you have to inform your insurer. So please copy us, send us a copy of that letter also.
Yeah.
And if they don't, they're in breach of the rules of the Law Society, and they're in breach in terms of the agreements they would have had with their own insurers, which is serious, because the insurers next year might turn around and say, well, we're not insuring you because you haven't declared or disclosed. Mm. Now, a bit more research. I think there's only about four companies on the island that will insure solicitors for professional indemnity. So it probably wouldn't do any harm to copy that same letter to all those other insurers. Okay?
Yeah, that could be quite powerful.
Oh, yeah. Now, again, I don't think it'd be that hard to establish who the insurers are. Again, and you could be writing directly to the insurers, informing them of the actions or the lack of action of the solicitor. And again, that would mess up. This is where it hurts the solicitors, you see. You see, again, the word solicit is very important. There's only one, the only thing the solicitors are in this for is what?
Well, they're in for money.
Money. That's it. So that's why they're called solicitors. They're soliciting for money. They agitate people. And at the end of the day, when you go into the High Court, it isn't a solicitor that will represent you. It'll be a barrister if you decide to go that route.
Yeah.
So all the solicitor's job traditionally is to solicit business, to get business. And that's it, to agitate, to fluff, or whatever you want to call it in the sexual context. And they do a good job, I have to say. Most of them do a good job. But again, you don't need them. You just don't need them, in my opinion. You can do all this without a solicitor, to be honest with you, if you decide, you know, you want to learn a bit.
Yeah.
But just to cap off, John, because I know you're sort of pushed on time there. The last section that we covered in Chapter 7, again, it's worth everybody's while reading this, but the last section, the last page, just covers a guy called Jeremy Malsting. At the time of writing this chapter, the Irish Life Permanent TSB appointed a new CEO called Jeremy Malsting. And I think people should just Google Jeremy Malsting and see where he comes from. He is now the Chief Operations Officer of the Permanent TSB, but he's got some interesting history. He worked for the British Cabinet and so on and so forth. But you'll see that I think we have covered a sort of a potted history of Jeremy in there. Very interesting character. And we did a credit check on him as well. We made a few friends in the financial services industry and we did a credit check. So we actually have Jeremy Malsting's home address. Now, we didn't publish it, but if need be, Tom may have to do, if something else happens at a later date, he may have to issue proceedings against Jeremy Malsting. But we have his home address for that purpose, if necessary, as we have with all of the directorate of Permanent TSB, because they are directors of, or were directors of the Permanent TSB, we have the home addresses, or the addresses they've registered as their home addresses. And that's public information anyway. Okay?
Okay, well, I think we've gone through a couple of very, Well, tangents is probably the wrong word, because the information is all pertaining to what's contained in the book, and some very, very interesting information. I particularly liked the Pierce Fitzgibbon angle, because a lot of people will have come into contact with them. Almost everybody who's ever gone through a toll and forgotten to pay it, because it's not the easiest thing in the world to pay. They don't make that easy, I think, deliberately. They will have come into contact more than likely with Pierce Fitzgibbon. So it's always good to show, I think, Des, that the law that we're talking about pertaining to mortgages or to unsecured debt can also be for a €2 toll fine or whatever extra levy that they decide to put on that. The law is the law. And once applied and applied correctly, it stands whether the amount is for €2 or €2 million. It doesn't actually matter.
No, it doesn't. There is a slight distinction. Now, there shouldn't be, but there is. When the state come after you, now, just to clarify this distinction, John, and then I suppose we can tidy up. But because you've raised it, I want to sort of clarify it.
Yeah.
And we may have covered it before, but nonetheless, there is a distinction between civil and criminal. Now, the book primarily is focused around civil issues, commercial issues. So it's all money related, blah, blah, blah. Now, the other distinction is criminal. Now, most people will be assuming, wrongly, that when you go through a toll road and you don't pay the charge, whatever it might be, that it's a civil offence because it relates to money. But it's not. It's actually a criminal charge. If or when they bring you into court, it is actually a criminal charge, and you could potentially be fined very heavily. And I don't know. I haven't looked at the regulations or act in relation to it, but potentially there might be a prison sentence. And specifically, there would be a prison sentence if you were in contempt of the court, i.e. you refused to pay the fine. So people need to understand, I suppose, that there is a distinction between civil and criminal. But the line is very, very, very thin. That one minute you might think, oh, this is a civil matter, it's about money. It's not. When the state attack, they're attacking you as a criminal. Okay? Just to be very clear about that. Parking fines, fees, any traffic-related offences, so on and so forth, automatically goes in as a criminal charge under a summary prosecution. Now, there's a difference again. There's summary prosecutions and there's indictable offences. And indictable offences are the more serious offences like rape, murder, kidnap, so on and so forth. But there, when you get charged in the circuit stroke district court, it's generally under summary prosecutions, but they are criminal prosecutions. People right. should remember that. And there's a separate way to deal with that, which we can cover at another time and another issue. But just to clarify that for people. Now, again, I want to highlight this for people, because people walk into this wall all the time. If you walk into any court and you say to the judge, is the matter civil or criminal? Now, sometimes the judge will just laugh at you, or they'll say you're in contempt of court, or they may be friendly towards you and say, well, look, I'm not here to give you legal advice. In other words, your ignorance of the law is no defense. The fact that you don't know that you're in for a criminal or civil matter is not my problem. You just seek legal advice.
Yeah.
And they might, if they're nice to you, they might say that to you. So don't be walking in and saying to the judge, is this civil or criminal? That means you don't know a damn thing about the case. And that's what you're telling the judge. And you're easy pickings and you're easy meat.
Yeah.
So you need to be aware of that, I think.
Well,
sorry, go on, John. Yeah, that's it.
No, good advice there. And it ties up Chapter 7 really nicely for us and will lead us into next week's video. And I suppose tutorial is the wrong word, but it's almost like an accompaniment to the book. And I think it's very, very worthwhile. So if there are any listeners out there who might be stumbling across this information for the first time, it is worth spreading. It's worth going to the website and getting your hands on the book as well. So remind us how people can do that, Des.
The website is irishlifeandme.com, very simply. They can download the chapters or they can procure a printed copy. And that's it, basically, irishlifeandme.com.
Fantastic. We'll talk again next week, and thanks for joining me again on Alchemy Xtra.
You're more than welcome, John. Thanks very much for having me.